My initial reaction was kind of, yes, I'd love to play this role because it's not something that I've seen before. But really, it came down to speaking with Atsuko, was I guess why I decided to sign on with the picture. It wasn't necessarily just reading the role, because I find more and more that in my career anyway, it's just it's really relieving to work with people that you feel like-minded. Atsuko's one of those directors that I felt like was going to make a special piece of work and allow the character to be as messy as he needed to be. And I think the character comes across that way in the end.
I guess the main thing for me was that we could draw a through line for ourselves, because we knew a lot of it wasn't going to be on screen, and that the character was always going to be intact from that point of view. I feel that character, and Atsuko agreed, and we had long conversations about this, so this is what it is. It's a very strange adjoinder, but he's escaped from his life, obviously, in the States, and is living a sort of he's living out a fantasy while he's in Japan, and he's allowed to be basically whoever he wants to be, and it seems as though he has always wanted to be an actor, and this is probably the only gig he could get in which he could play multiple different roles and also kind of connect with people, which is ultimately what he wants to do, and I think people want to do even more so when they're taken away from their culture, find a way to connect. Once he's taken out of that, and I don't think he ever wanted to go back to the States if he could help it, once he's convinced by Mika to go back to the States, his life starts, you know, he comes face to face with his old life, and his life falls apart. You know, he falls apart, which he was already sort of half-baked to begin with, and before he left, I think, so. That he's a failing striver, I guess. I found that interesting. You don't find a lot of characters that are failing strivers that are sort of highlighted in films these days, or I haven't seen a lot of scripts with that, so. And that he doesn't really, I also like that he doesn't really come to terms with himself in a way during the film. Maybe that final moment in a way, but it's not much, you know? It's not a story of his reckoning. It's, you know, it's someone else's story, but he's sort of forced to see himself, but we don't really get that part of the story. It's more just him actively deluding himself, and I found it charming, sort of. I don't know. It seemed clear to me in the script that the character was wearing a very thin mask, and that the moment he was challenged, he would fall apart. Writing that line is really fun for an actor, because you're constantly, I mean, you're putting it all out there. You're not holding much back. He's not a deep well, you know. He just wants to be loved. He's a people pleaser, and he's not good at pleasing people, you know. I that sounds so trite, but it's kind of true, right? I enjoy people who are on the edge. I like playing those kind of people, because it's more difficult, you know. It's not. I can tell you a dumb story. Yeah, okay. There was an actor who's a friend of a friend, who used to tell himself on set. He would sit there right before he was about to do a take, and he'd be like, "You have a secret. None of them know your secret. Go." And it was like, that was his way to create depth for the character, you know? Okay. And it sort of worked. And I was like, oh, yeah. I guess that's, you know, in a way you can fool the audience with some of that stuff for some of the time. I prefer characters that are very much, that are wrestling with something right on the surface, that they're kind of a mess, I like that. I'm drawn to it. It feels not only challenging, but it feels realistic to me, because so much of film, what's nice about film and what's nice about theater is that we get to see people outside of their public self. And I think in a private, a lot of us are a lot messier than we pretend to be in public. Atsuko defined me recently as rebellious, but I think that I am ultimately a people pleaser at heart, and knowing that I am a people pleaser at heart has forced me to rebel, because if I were to just go along with everything everybody wanted me to do, I'd be someone else. And so I have to, in order to kind of keep any semblance of who I am, I have to push back, you know? So with, you know, with any relationship, whether it be in film or just personal relationships, I have to keep an eye on how much I'm doing for other people and how much I'm doing for myself, and try to hit that balance. And more and more, because I have two kids now, it's not for me anymore at all, ever. And I have to be okay with that now. So that's just the way it is. But yeah. We had a conversation about this toward the end of the film, actually. Whether he loved Mika, whether he was... And I don't think he loved Setsuko. I don't think he really loved his wife anymore. He probably had... It seems to me like he has an emotional availability to most people. And that's because he's yearning for some affection that he's not getting. And that's the way I felt about him. But he doesn't want to hurt anybody, I think, is the ultimate sort of key to John's character, is that it seems like he does a lot of bad things, but it's mostly because he has bad judgment. And he's not... He doesn't have a strong spine, you know. He's not going to stand up for much, especially if it's going to hurt. And that's kind of how I saw John. I actually think that when he saw how his probably the moment after the film, John sort of develops a conscience, you know, kind of starts to think of himself as a defining characteristic in his own life, as opposed to being along for the ride and put upon, I think, is part of John's problem. So no, I don't think he was in love with any of them, but he felt something for them. You tell me if that's correct. Okay.